Some of y'all saying, why would I be here? What am I gonna do after this? You know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna go sit down, take my seat, and bask in the presence of the Lord. That's what I'm gonna do. Because I trust God. I trust God. So the word behold is a game changer right there. He was saying, look yet, not look at me. Look what I'm about to tell you what's going on. Look what I'm about to tell you to do. And that's what Jesus was saying to John and Mary. To send him, to send her with him. He knew. He could have sent her with Peter. He could have sent her with anybody. He could have sent her with Joseph. He could have sent her with anybody. Right. Mary was Mary, right? Yes, she was. But he chose John. Why did he choose John? Don't nobody know God's plan, but he did. And when God chooses somebody, God do not make no mistake. I leave y'all saying, behold, amen.
reading Matthew 27, starting at verse 45. It says, "Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land unto the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" Forsaken, meaning to be abandoned, deserted, left helpless. Jesus had been on the cross at this time. He was at Golgotha, and he had been there for about 3 hours already, hanging, bleeding, sweating blood. And it was dark, and the darkness represented judgment. And it had fallen all over the land. And again, it was the ninth hour. And in my studies, I discovered that the ninth hour was the time that they would do the daily sacrifice, which was interesting to me as we had Jesus on the cross, who was the vicarious sacrifice. At the ninth hour, he decided to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? This was the first time in eternity that God had ever turned his back and was not what we would say with him. Amen. And so it reminded me about the priest and how when they would do the sacrifices and they would go into the holies of holies, they had to go alone. And so then I thought about myself, and I feel that this text was certainly appropriate for me. And I played the song because, you know, sometimes you feel unworthy. And I certainly will admit to you all that I am a wretch undone. And it is because of his grace and his mercy. And I am so encouraged tonight to understand that I'm already loved. No matter what I did yesterday, no matter what I did last week, no matter what I'm going to do tonight when I get home, I'm already loved. And I'm already forgiven. And so when the priests would go into the holies of holies, they had to go alone. And so I encourage you tonight, you may feel like you're in a place of forsakenness, but understand that there is victory on the other side. Amen. And Jesus, he was the sinless sacrifice. He was the lamb that presented himself to take away the sins of the world. He lost the comfort of the Holy Spirit. The presence of God had departed from him for the first and only time. And he then experienced, I was reading in the Legionnaire ministry, and it said that he had the unassisted solitariness abandonment, and that he experienced the undiluted wrath of God. And he experienced it so that we would not have to, because my God, if he would have allowed his wrath to come upon me just this week alone, I wouldn't be standing here. Amen. And so I am grateful for the love and the kindness and the death of Jesus Christ, because he became sin. He who knew no sin became sin for a wretch like me. In 2 Corinthians verse 5, chapter 21, it says, "For our sake he made himself to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." So I can stand here today, having messed up just 25 minutes ago, and say that I am the righteousness of God. And if I would have used for something, it would have simply been, make me an altar. I had told Pastor about how I was at work at Union Memorial, and this man, he was a Muslim. He had a broken bedside table. The sign was written on it, and it said broken. And I guess it was his time to pray. He sat down in front of the broken sign on the nurse's unit, and he began to pray. And when I walked by, I said, my God. That thing struck me like a bolt of lightning. I said, look at him. He's praying to his God in the midst of this nursing station and a dirty corner. He's made an altar. And God said to me, that's what I want my people to do. I want them to start making me an altar, my God. And it looks like the time that I got the revelation looked like the devil just got all inside of me. And I didn't even realize how to make an altar. I don't know what I became, a wretch undone. But I thank God, because he saved me from being forsaken. He came so that I would not experience the undiluted wrath of God. He became a curse for me when I was the accursed. Amen. Hallelujah. And I like the fact that when he was on the cross and he said, my God, he said it twice, but he referenced God's position despite being forsaken. My God. 2 minutes. The things that we do when we're faced with suffering, sometimes we shrink back and we go back to the sins that we're comfortable with, the things that brought us comfort, that's only momentarily. That may be to go back to drugs, to go back to sex, to go back to gambling, to go back to the things that we have no business. Or we just accept the pain and we say, this is just how supposed to be. I'm never going to make it. I'm never going to matter. Nobody's ever going to love me. Nobody's ever going to respect me. And not understanding that there is a far more exceeding weight of glory. That's 2 Corinthians verse 4, chapter 17. It says, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. And so the true choice for us believers, when we feel forsaken, is to invite the growth and participate with the Holy Ghost. And so understand that we're already loved. We're going to mess up and make mistakes, but participate in your process. Do you not abort the process because of the pain that you've been inflicted, all right? I got 1 minute. I'm going to close with this. I got to see a live representation of sacrifice on Thursday. My nephew, he went to the Navy, and I said, why his parents not act? I said, I was trying to hold myself back. I said, they all, you know, they just sitting there, they all together, and putting. I'm just trying to push the tears back, and my sister-in-law said, I'm not at a funeral, and I'm not at a courthouse. Prepared her baby, who was twice her size in height, to submit him for the sacrifice of service. And it blessed my spirit, you know, because I said that's just what Mary had to do. She had to nurse him. She had to change his diapers. She had to wipe his knees when he's got scuffed up in preparation for the cross. Time's up. That's all right. I'm obedient. Participate with your process.
Father knew that right before he was going to be offered up, he wanted to be purified. by his lips. Thank God for him offering for himself for us. Because I look at us, and I look at the wells that sometimes we find ourselves in. And the wells, we dig deeper and deeper a hole for ourselves. We think that the wells is going to do us well. When they come out to do us real dirty. And when you hit those wells and you hit those dry spots, sometimes in life you want to curl up under a box and don't want to come out. You don't want nobody to see your face and you don't want to see nobody else's face. But when you know that you got a thirst and a hunger and you just can't find it nowhere else and you went everywhere else to try to be fulfilled or try to be satisfied and you can't be satisfied, then you have to go to only one person that I know that you can go to, that can satisfy you, that can fill your hunger, that can give you the thirst. Now, before I was thirsty, I was first. Now I'm thirsty. Because now I know nothing satisfies me now. My lips are dry. I'm craving for something now. And when you can do it, when you've done all you can do, and everything else fails, you fall on your knees and you get that quench. Oh, you get that quench from the one fountain that don't run dry. That fountain that never ends. That fountain that serves living water in your belly. That fountain that will take you to another height, that take you to another place. That fountain that, whoa, will not let you down. Thank you, Jesus. And the fountain I tapped into, I don't know about y'all, but I found out that when I was on this path, I tried everything. I tried not eating. I tried not sleeping. I tried not talking. I tried getting attitudes with people. I tried some other things too. But nothing could satisfy that quench. All along, while I was trying all these things, Jesus was right there looking me in the face. He said, all you got to do is pick me back up, son, and get back on this road where you left me, and we can ride this thing out together. And once I touched into Jesus' hands, once I got an enemy camp and I tapped into Jesus, he took me to another level. He delivered me from the hands of my enemies. He delivered me from the hands of my enemies. And just like he delivered me, when Jesus was on that cross, when he tapped into his verse, God delivered him from the hands of the enemy and bore him up with him, and they became one. Yes. Just like us, if we tap into Jesus today, there's no level, there's no height, there's no depth, there's nothing out of life that God can't do for us. If God is with us, we can be against us. I declare today that if you don't know Jesus and the bargain is sin, you better get him quick and all right. Righteousness is right. Holiness is right. Sanctification is right. And it's through Jesus Christ which you're going to obtain all those things. You couldn't do it on your own. If we could do it on our own, there was no need for Jesus to come down and die on the cross for us. Every time I think I got it right, I get it wrong. I just can't get that form out of my flesh. But guess what? Jesus came and showed me how to work with that form, work that thing out. And he used what was supposed to kill me for my good. He used what was supposed to kill me to deliver people. He used what was supposed to kill me to declare his name and his word. He used what he heard what the world talked about me and looked down on me. He used it to raise me up and take me to another level. He used it to blow up the kingdom of God. Yes, Lord. Jesus is so bigger than what we know. He's bigger than his church. He's bigger than your house. He's bigger than everything. It's the Jesus on the inside of you that makes all the difference. And you ain't never got to set foot in church. But you got God on the inside of you. He take you to a place and can show you things that you could never imagine you could obtain. Yeah. And Lord Jesus, Father God. Thank you, Jesus. As I sit and just think about what my Jesus did for me. It become a personal thing when you meditate on it. Because we all had encounters with one day or another. If you haven't had encounters with him, I suggest you have one with him. The encounter I had with God was a rendezvous. And once you've been touched, you're not going back. It's a touch and a kindle fire like no other. I got hit like the Apostle Paul on the road. And while I was on the road, I wasn't necessarily on the right way. But when God hit me, he knocked me back on path and got me straight. He put my knees back in line and my joints got back in order. My Lord, sometimes God needs to hit you upside your head to get you back on track. I got hit upside my head. Oh, excuse me, I'm sorry. Just this morning, I got hit upside my head. I had to go back to what I used to do. Fast and praying. It make all the difference in the world. And I tell you, it wasn't 2 hours before the change came about. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you all.
Something about how he gave us instructions for living even as he died. He fulfilled his purpose even in his pain. And even as we